Hello. In this video, we will introduce additional structure to our known vector space in the form of an inner product. In particular, the inner product will help us in studying geometric properties of vectors and spaces, such as angles and orthogonality between elements. Similarly, like the norm, the inner product on a vector space is defined axiomatically. And by definition, an inner product is a mapping which relates two elements of the vector space to a complex number. The first axiom of the definition requires that if we take an inner product of a vector with itself, then the result should be a real number, and more precisely a non-negative real number. In addition, the inner product with the vector itself is allowed to be zero precisely if x is the zero vector. The second axiom requires that if the second component of the inner product is a fixed vector zeta, then the inner product is linear in the first component. And finally, the third axiom requires that reversing the order of the elements in the inner product has the effect of changing the value of the inner product to its complex conjugate. And combining the last two axioms also shows that the second component of the inner product has a linearity type property, but with additional complex conjugations of the scalars. And this property is referred to as antilinearity or conjugate linearity in the literature. Especially the first axiom of the inner product very much resembles the first axiom of a norm. And in fact, there's a strong connection with the definitions, since every inner product turns out to also define a specific norm on the vector space. More precisely, the norm induced by the inner product is defined as the square root of the inner product of the vector x with itself. And this expression is well defined, since the first axiom of the inner product required that this inner product with x with itself is always a non-negative real number. Otherwise, it's quite straightforward to show that the induced norm is indeed a norm in the sense that it satisfies the axioms that are required, but the triangle inequality is based on an intermediate result, which is also an incredibly useful tool by itself in analysis. The Cauchy-Schwarz inequality is indeed satisfied by every inner product and the norm that it induces, and it states that the modulus of the inner product is always bounded from above by the product of the norms of the two elements. And using this inequality, the fact that the induced norm satisfies the triangle inequality can be proved in exactly the same way as is usually done in the case of the norm on Euclidean spaces. And as the conclusion, we have that every inner product space is also a normed space. And if we do not state otherwise, then we always consider the inner product space precisely with the norm induced by the inner product. Since every inner product space is also a normed space, we can also consider the completeness of the space. And this way we arrive at the main concept of this section, namely Hilbert spaces. By definition, a Hilbert space is an inner product space which is complete with respect as a normed space. And here we again consider the normed space properties of x with respect to the norm, which is induced by the inner product. And similarly, as in the case of normed spaces, the completeness of the space is highly dependent on the choice of the inner product. And therefore, the Hilbert space property depends closely on both the vector space X and the particular inner product. Since the definition here can be restated as saying that Hilbert space is an inner product, which is also a Banach space, we can see that all Hilbert spaces are Banach spaces. And in fact, Hilbert spaces have relatively strong properties even compared to other Banach spaces. And many of these special properties that Hilbert spaces possess do indeed tend to have this geometric nature. We can now consider a couple of examples of inner product spaces and Hilbert spaces. On the Lebesgue space of square integrable functions, we can define an inner product of two functions f and g as the integration of the product of the values of f and the complex conjugates of the values of g over the domain omega. And this integral expression is indeed well defined for all f and g in L2, because the Hölder's inequality for integrals implies that this product of the two functions is integrable over omega. To verify that this formula defines an inner product, we can check that the three axioms of the inner product are satisfied. For the first axiom, if we take the inner product of f with itself, we can see that the result is the integration of the square of the modulus of fc over omega, which is in particular always non-negative as the integral of a non-negative function. And in fact, this expression is quite familiar because it is precisely the square of the natural 2 norm on the space L2. And if we want to skip ahead here, we can see that this expression we have shows that the inner product we've defined will in fact induce the 2 norm, provided of course that all the other axioms of the inner product are satisfied. The second part of the first axiom, the fact that the inner product of f with itself is zero precisely if f is zero, follows directly from our previous computation here, together with the properties of the 2 norm on L2. And the second axiom, the linearity of the inner product with respect to its first component, it's quite easy to verify based on the linearity of the Lebesgue integration. And finally, the third axiom follows from suitably rearranging the complex conjugations in the integrals. We get that all of the inner product axioms are satisfied. Now that we've verified that what we've defined here is really an inner product, we can deduce that L2 is an inner product space with this chosen inner product. And in addition, since L2 is a Banach space when equipped with the 2 norm, and since we already saw that this norm is induced by our inner product here, we have that L2 is in fact complete as a normed space and therefore a Hilbert space. This is quite a special property of the Lebesgue space L2 among the scale of Lebesgue spaces, and while some of the other LP spaces with different exponents P can also be equipped with an inner product, especially if omega is a compact set, the space L2 is the only only one of these spaces which is complete in a product space. As our second example, we can consider the space small L2 of square summable sequences. And this space can be equipped with an inner product with which resembles the inner product on the finite dimensional Euclidean space Cn. And this inner product between vectors x and y, or sequences x and y, is defined as the infinite sum of the products of the elements of the two sequences. And here the elements of the sequence yk have been complex conjugated. The fact that this expression is well defined follows again from Hölder's inequality now for sequences, which implies that this complex sequence here converges absolutely when x and y are both in small L2. The verification of the axioms of the inner product can be done in an analogous manner as in the case of the Lebesgue space L2, and it's presented in detail in the lecture notes. And also in the case of this space, we can deduce that it is first of all a well-defined inner product space. Moreover, since the inner product we've defined here turns out to induce the natural two norm on our space, we can see that L2 is in fact a Hilbert space when equipped with this inner product. And similarly, as in the case of Lebesgue spaces, the space L2 is in fact the only Hilbert space among the Banach spaces LP of p summable sequences with different exponents p.